On this episode of Still Loading, Mario gets a face ship. Hello, everyone, and welcome to this new episode of the Still Loading podcast. I'm your host, Josh Koval, and it is the last episode of Mario Month. We have gone 4 weeks in a row exploring Mario games as we do every March. And, you know, the last year, it was all about speed running. And this year, I decided to get back to the games, and we're capping it off with a truly great Mario game. At least in my opinion, it's a truly great Mario game. We are talking Super Mario Galaxy 2, which came out in May of 2010. And with me today, two returning guests, one from just earlier this year, and another guest from, I don't even remember. Dan, do you remember how long ago I had you on? Was it last year or 2 years ago?
I vaguely believe it was the Taft administration, but don't quote me.
Oh, man, we hide our age well. So let's go with you. So the first guest that I would like to announce, we have Dan Greenberg, a.k.a. Winter Ion Games. Dan, how are you doing today?
Doing great. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for coming back onto the show. It has been quite some time since I had you on. I'll have to double check that which episode I actually had you on. I can't remember if it was last year or the year before. But anyway, thank you so much for coming on. And returning from earlier this year from his feature phone preservation episode, we have Rockman Cosmo. Cosmo, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good. Thanks for having me on.
Thank you for coming back. When I was putting feelers out, I was saying, yeah, I'm doing Mario Month. And you said, wow, I love Mario games, but don't tell the Rockman community. So is that still a point of contention for you in the community?
Oh, no. No, I was just joking. No, I don't think they're going to do anything to me. I mean the series also starts with an M, so it's fine.
It counts. It's all part of the same alphabet. Yeah, so we are discussing Super Mario Galaxy and Super Mario Galaxy 2. And man, this game's, I did a decent amount of research on it. And actually, before we dive in, Dan, you were on the show almost 2 years ago in 2021. So there we go. It's
wow.
Been, yeah, that time flies, dude. I can't believe it was that long ago already. It really doesn't feel that long ago.
No.
But yeah, we are here to talk Super Mario Galaxy 2. So as we always do with the beginnings of the episodes, let's talk about our personal memories and attachment to it. So Dan, I want to start off with you, since you're the long returning guest, since it's been quite some time. I want to hear your thoughts. How did you first discover Super Mario Galaxy 2, or what are some of your personal experiences with it?
So I had an interesting meeting with the Super Mario Galaxy series and Galaxy 2 in particular, because I didn't own a Nintendo Wii when it was a prevalent system. I came to it later, despite friends and family having it and kind of seeing what the Nintendo Wii did in kind of redemocratizing the living room. I didn't own one personally, but I did get a Wii U, and Galaxy 2 was one of the first games that they made available to download. So I got a digital copy of Super Mario Galaxy 2 on the Wii U and played it that way. So I was a little late to playing it, but I remember just being sort of instantly entranced by it. And it was also, I guess, a little different approach for me because I played 2 before 1. Playing 2 is actually what made me go back and play 1, and then kind of understand just the similarities and the differences. And it was so stark to kind of take that backwards path that I couldn't help but be, you know, curious about the game. So I actually spent a decent amount of time playing both. But from a personal standpoint, I think too, there is a little bit of that. I mea culpa is a little more endearing because it is the first Galaxy game I played.
Nice. That's interesting. That's a very interesting perspective to come at it from. I actually played the first game first. But like you, I didn't have a Wii at launch. I didn't play either of these games when they were contemporary. But unlike you, I actually played Galaxy 1 first. So that's interesting. So, Cosmo, what about you? What are your personal experiences with this game?
So, it's hard to not talk about Galaxy 2 and not mention my gaming journey kind of from the beginning, but I'll still try to condense it around Galaxy 2 in particular.
Sounds good.
So ever since the very beginning, gaming was really looked down by my parents because, like most other parents when you're a kid, they thought I had better things to do. Like the phrase "fry your brain" was thrown around a ton. My family, you know, like, don't play the video games, they're gonna fry your brain, better go, I don't know, study or something like that. So for most of my childhood until around age 5 or 6, all I played were edutainment games on this thing called the Leapster or the Didge. There's very hard to describe, they kind of look like GBAs and they got cartridges you put in there, and basically that was the only world of gaming that I knew. But I still engage with franchises like Sonic. So, for example, they had like Sonic on the Didge. You know, it was like, kind of like a port of Sonic 1 and 2, except they'd have these giant rings. And when you hit the ring, it would freeze the game, and you go into like a math problem or a word problem. And I remember playing that and thinking to myself, I just want to play this Sonic game, but without the giant rings. Like, that was my entire perspective on gaming. I had no idea there's anything outside of it. So I would only get brief glimpses of this outside world when I visited my grandparents' or cousin's house because they had a PS3 and a Wii. And I think my first ever true gaming experience was Wii Play, but I wasn't even playing the game because my cousin was playing like the game where you shake the Wii remote to jump, I think you're on a horse. Mm-hmm. And I was alongside him and I was trying to do the motions myself, but I wasn't doing anything, but I was kind of enthralled. Like, my goodness, you know, this is pure fun and not like, you know, education you put into it, you know. So even though I saw those games on those trips, like, my playtime would be really limited, like 30 to 45 minutes a day. So yeah, really, really clamped down upon. And I don't know why, but my grandparents got me a black Wii with Wii Sports Resort and Wii Sports packed in. And like, my lack of knowledge about the circumstances around gaming at the time goes to show, because like, I don't know why they got it for me. I don't know if it was for Christmas, my birthday. It just happened one day. Mm-hmm. And when I played that, it was kind of treated like a sin. So my playtimes would always max out at like an hour and only be on weekends. And the built-in clock on the Wii didn't really help either. So my parents could just check if, you know, I was lying about the playtime.
Oh my God.
So it was really limited. And I don't know how. So once again, I don't know. But I somehow ended up with Mario Galaxy 1. And I don't remember if it was my first Mario game, because I think I might have tried New Super Mario Bros. Wii from like a Blockbuster rental prior. But I do remember loving Galaxy 1 until I got stuck at PD Piranha. Then I quit the game forever. I was like, I'm done. This is trash.
Isn't that the first boss?
Yeah, that's the first boss.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Yeah, exactly. Because, you know, my limited playtime, it couldn't allow me to truly sink my teeth into the game. And I also had other stuff I was doing. So then one day when I go to Blockbuster, I see Galaxy 2 on the rack. And for some reason, the cover art, Mario and Yoshi, that just enticed me. Something about it just seemed more fun than Galaxy 1 to my young brain. Maybe it might have been the colors. So then I rent the game for a weekend, which means 2 hours of gameplay max, and I am enthralled. But unfortunately, I have to return the game. But the effect it leaves on my brain is just, like, everlasting. So that Christmas, I write to Santa Claus, and I ask for Galaxy 2. And Santa writes back to me, and he says, "Don't you already have the first one?" somehow I think for my birthday I'm giving Galaxy 2, but even then I actually only made it past World 1 and I quit for years. But the game's impact stayed with me forever because it showed me kind of for the first time what video games could be, and I never experienced something like that up to that point.
Wow, that's amazing. Like, I mean, that's such an interesting window into gaming. That's crazy. Like, I would have, that's one of the first times I've ever, I mean, I remember hearing, you know, my parents would also limit my game time, but it's interesting to see it coming from, especially now that you're part of, I mean, I guess I should have shouted it out at the top, you know, the Feature Phone Preservation Project, and like, you've done a lot of work in the MegaMan / Rockman community. So it's really interesting to see that, like, you were so, like, your parents limited it so much, and now you're really heavily involved in the community.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, when I did research for this episode, it really did make me reflect on the whole gaming journey. I thought to myself, I really should not be where I am right now, because if I just stayed on that track, like, video games would have been just like a totally by the wayside. Never even would have known about it. But guess. I mean, thank God for Galaxy 2.
But Santa laid the gauntlet down at that point. You had to.
That's true, yeah.
He wrote back. Wow.
Yeah, can't believe it. Very, very personal.
I mean, this is confirmation that Santa's real, folks. I mean, you're hearing it first.
100%, yeah.
Oh, my God, that's wild. That's just crazy. So for myself, I don't have any strong formative memories of first playing this. Like I know you guys have not heard the first Mario Galaxy episode that's been recorded, but you know, has not released at the time we're recording this. But my experience with Galaxy 1 was I had just moved in with my fiance, now wife. And so it was very much like I was putting this at a place in time. You know, like I'm very nostalgic for Galaxy 1 because of what was happening in my life at that time. Galaxy 2, I remember hearing on Retronauts and other podcasts that like it's kind of like an unsung Mario game in the sense that it's really good, but not a lot of people really talk about it because they either focus on Galaxy 1 or the new Super Mario Bros. Series. And I mean, it's funny. I remember when 2020 was here and we were ended, or 2020 came to an end or whatever, and everyone was doing, you know, like the top 10 games of the decade, and you're looking at all the games that came out in between. I guess it was at the end of 2019 and it was leading into 2020, but it was, you know, the top 10 games of the decade, and everyone was looking through 2010 through 2019. This game, it just barely squeaks in. No one really remembers it because it just kind of, you know, it came out of the early in the year, early in the decade. It also, in a weird sense, it kind of seems intentional. Well, it was semi-intentional. This is almost like Mario Galaxy 1.5. And that's not necessarily an insult, though some people may look at it that way. That was actually somewhat intentional as well. They kind of started off with this with the idea of like, well, it's just, we already have this engine that we spent so much time to make Galaxy 1 with. Let's reuse it and make a whole, come up with a whole bunch of new ideas. And as they kept adding ideas, they're like, well, this is enough to fill a whole new game. And so Galaxy 2 came out. I do find it weird, though, that the storyline for this, I didn't know this. I just, you know, Mario games aren't really known for the story. Apparently, it's just a retelling of Galaxy 1.
Yeah, I look at now Galaxy 1 and Galaxy 2, and the impression I get with Galaxy 2 is it's as if they played Super Mario Galaxy and said, this is a lot of fun. Imagine if this was a Mario game. And what I mean by that is the primary differences between the two, the tonal shift, how much brighter the second one is, the variance in the worlds, the tightness of the level design, sort of those refinements and perfections that you kind of tend to establish when you think of these, you know, tentpole Nintendo franchises. Galaxy 2 has all of that in spades, and you can see it, especially in like the initial reviews for this game. Mm-hmm. I mean, just tens down the board from all of these publications, this universal acclaim. It just got such a massively positive response in the moment, in the community and playing it. But you're right, because the story is kind of it's almost as if someone is retelling and passing the rough concept of what happens in Mario Galaxy, but without those sort of big, almost sweeping RPG style elements. And speaking as an RPG fan, like, I love what they tried to do in going outside the box a little bit with the storytelling, but it isn't very Mario. It is really different from a typical Mario game. And Galaxy 2, in a lot of ways, is what if you took Super Mario Galaxy and made a Mario-style game out of it? A lot of the refinements, a lot of the changes that they make to the game is pulling it kind of closer to their own brand, as it were.
At first, I was, when you said like it's becoming more of a Mario game, at first I was offended on behalf of the developers. But then the more you kind of described it, I actually think I kind of agree with you. I think that you're right, because Galaxy 1, see, spoiler alert, I still love Galaxy 2, but I actually prefer Galaxy 1 over it. And I don't know if it's the nostalgia or if it's just the the fact, like the nostalgia, you know, of what was happening in my life at the time, or is it that I love the Comet Observatory in Galaxy One? But you are 100% right. It doesn't. It's so different from a stereotypical Mario game. It doesn't feel that way. And it's interesting. What's weird about Galaxy 1 and 2 in the comparison, Galaxy 1 was Koizumi really trying to, and this is Yoshiaki Koizumi, he was really trying to force a narrative into the Mario games, because that's what he's always trying to do. He's always trying to add narrative to Mario games, and Miyamoto famously doesn't give two shits about narrative and just wants to doesn't think it's that important. He focuses more on the gameplay. So what's interesting when you look at Mario Galaxy 1 and 2, it's almost like Koizumi and Miyamoto had an argument, and in Galaxy 1 Koizumi won the argument, and in Galaxy 2 Miyamoto won the argument. You know, they kind of went with their own styles a little bit. Both are very similar, obviously, because they're both Galaxy games. But you nailed it, Dan. Like, if even look at the overworld layout, like, you don't have the Comet Observatory anymore. You have a map system again. It's kind of similar to, you know, Super Mario Bros. 3 or Super Mario World, and you travel along this map. It's a lot less of Super Mario 64 kind of had a central hub, and that's kind of like what Galaxy has, but it still doesn't feel quite the same. So it's interesting to see those differences.
And in a very convenient map, too. I mean, the layout, the UI kind of showing you what you've done so far in a lot of these stages, and, you know, clear indication for prankster comets. And it's just a really well-designed, because the game is, well, I'm sure we'll get into this, such a massive collectathon, not in the traditional sense, but in the that you are going to each of these levels so many times, digging around, finding things, really exploring each of these spaces, that it just helps that the game is very friendly about showing you what you have and haven't yet done.
Yeah, yeah. Rock or Cosmo, what are some of your early thoughts on the game? Just some of the gameplay stuff we've been talking about.
Yeah, I mean, Dan pretty much hit the nail on the head, and basically what Galaxy 2 is, it being, I guess, more of a Mario game. And I also noticed that I feel like there are more callbacks to other Mario games here. Like, you got that throwback Galaxy, you got a bunch of other elements that are kind of taken from a few other, like, Mario games. Like, I think that, what was it? It had a bunch of giant blocks, right? Like,
yes, Supermassive Galaxy.
Yeah, Supermassive Galaxy. Yeah, that was also, yeah, definitely like a big callback. And yeah, it's kind of like they're just straying closer and closer to that, that I wouldn't say 2D Mario formula, because this is obviously, you know, not a 2D game. It's got some original elements of its own, but then, like, it's almost like you can chart the path from 64 all the way to something like 3D World, and that, you know, going with the map system, you can see that where they're getting a little more linear with it, and they're not making you run into open space, getting to different levels. But yeah, I mean, I'm a little bit the opposite of what you said, Josh. I kind of prefer the hub world. Maybe we could talk about that here too, like the Starship Mario over the Comet Observatory. I don't know, something for some reason just stuck with me about it when I first saw it. Maybe it was the whole face ship pun. I don't know. I still remember that to this day. But like, I remember after, like, just completing levels and seeing, like, different characters, you know, gradually appear on that. I don't know, that just stuck with me forever. I remember the first time I saw the ship, I went to my room and I had this Lego pirate ship. I transformed that into an airship, and that was like,
nice.
And I still have that, I think, to this day somewhere lying around. And that was just, I don't know, I'd never seen something like that before. And just that interactivity with the world, like, every single time you get a new power up, I would check the little engine room. Like, I didn't know you could go down, like, the chimney on the top. Like, I mean, probably people who have played, like, 64, they're like, what is this guy talking about? You know, 64, he had so many other secrets. But I don't know, something about this face ship just left an impression on me.
You'll appreciate this, Josh. Strong dad energy from Lubba, yes?
100%.
I mean, and it's all of the just, you know, and obviously I was a lot younger back then. It was, you know, completely different world. What am I saying? It was like 7 or 8 years ago. But yeah, just he's this sort of comedic anchor for a place that you visit, right, a ton, because every time you get a star, you get kicked out of the world you're in. You're back there on the ship. So you're getting a ton of interaction with him. Very, very likable character to be stuck with.
I like the face ship, in all honesty. Like, I still like the Comet Observatory more, but what I like about the face ship, I do like the engine room. I feel like there's lots of secrets on it. Like, the Comet Observatory had some, but I feel like this has a lot of things that, like, you could go back and play it, and unless you know the game completely inside and out, you're going to discover something new almost every time you explore that face ship. That's how it always felt to me, at least. And I have to shout out on the face ship, the music. Love the track they play for the face ship. Is, you know what it sounds like to me? It sounds like something out of a Ghibli film. Would you agree with that? Do you guys hear that in that at all?
I can hear that. Yeah,
arrangement certainly.
I love it so much. Like, it's so happy. It's so pleasant. It really is a wonderful song. So this game, I was reading an Iwata Asks on it, and it's supposed, they said there was three directors on the game, but they listed them all. But when I look at like Wikipedia and like other sources, it lists them all separate. So, you know, Koizumi went from being the director of Super Mario Galaxy 1, and now he was the producer of this game. And then the three directors they referenced is Koichi Hayashida, Kenta Motokura, and who is it? Hayakawa. What's his first name? Takeshi Hayakawa. Hayakawa was the lead programmer. Motokura was the lead designer, and then Hayashida is credited as the director. Now, Hayashida, I thought, was kind of cool. Shout out to former or previous guest of the show, Game Dave. Hayashida was the director of a game called Joy Mech Fight, which Game Dave covered in one of his Family Corner episodes.
Great show, great segment.
Right? What such a cool idea for a segment on his YouTube channel. One of the best shows that I've watched on YouTube. And I'm not a big fighting game fan, but Joy Mech Fight, if you look at that game is stunning for an NES game. Like, I know it's a late game, which is why it looks so good, but it still is impressive. So when I saw that this guy, because he was talked about, like, Iwata was saying, is this your first time directing? He's like, well, I did also directed Joy Mech Fight, but that was obviously, at that time, that was over a decade prior. Oh, mm-hmm. My gosh. Hold the phone. If you think about Mario Galaxy came out in 2007, right? I believe the first one. Joy Mech Fight, I got to see when this game came out. Because if it's...
I mean, it can't be later than what, 92 or 93?
Right? 93. There is only a 14-year difference between those two games. And that is so many console generations in between. That is just nuts. That's not that much time. Sorry, that blew my mind. Sorry.
I mean, to be fair, it's a Famicom game coming out a couple years before the N64 launched. I mean,
yeah, that's why it's just such a weird, like, it's an anomaly almost. It's very strange. But yeah, so those were the three directors, as far as I could tell. Miyamoto suggested the sequel, and that's how they, you know, that. In kind of in the same vein of what Majora's Mask was to Ocarina of Time, where they wanted to create a sequel to using the same engine. So similarly to Majora's Mask, that's why it was kind of like, in a weird sense, it was kind of their inspiration to an extent, with, you know, not necessarily gameplay wise, but taking the idea of refining a concept from a previous game engine, which I thought was kind of cool. Now, Miyamoto, in the Iwata Ask interview, Miyamoto talks a lot about it, Koizumi references it later on, that he wanted this game to resonate, quote unquote, with fans, like almost like somehow in trying to, it's almost like he was trying to design resonance into as a game, not mechanic, but. I was having a hard time figuring out what exactly he meant by resonate. Like, you obviously, when a game resonates, someone has an emotional response to it. That's how I kind of interpret it, right? So, like, how do you design with resonance in mind? Like, that was such a interesting way to think about it.
Well, there's two parts to that, right? To the idea that you want this sort of, not emotional, but like this attachment. But he also says he wants fans, right? So, you know, what do you mean by that? Is it necessarily that you want nostalgia, you want callbacks? We talked about some of those things. Or is it that you want the gameplay or the style of the game to be one that people who are fans of the series recognize and can attach to? And not to kind of circle back to what I'm saying is I feel like Galaxy 2 is the Mario-ification of Galaxy 1. But I do feel like a lot of the design decisions were made in this, how do I make this as Mario as I can? Because you have this really great engine. You're getting so much out of the Nintendo Wii. I went back and looked. The draw distance in some of these levels is crazy. And that's such an innocent thing to think about. But from a design standpoint, you get to some of these stages, like the one where the Rainbow Road is swirling around, some of the ones where you're using the Dash Pepper, and you're seeing all these sweeping ramps and sort of the design as you're kind of camera panning into Mario's location as he's kind of flying in. And it really is just impressive to see the scope in the presentation there. So you do kind of get this whimsical every time you go into a stage, this sort of exciting rush of what you're about to kind of jump into.
I also wonder if like they were able to do stuff like that because of how like Nintendo obviously is great at what they do, but Cosmo, I think you sent me a link to a video on the tech, like on how like textures in Super Mario Galaxy 2. Do you know what I'm talking about? Remember that video you sent me?
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, I remember that.
Do you think you could elaborate a little bit into that? I watched it as well, but I think it's something that would be worth talking about, just kind of talking about the genius of Nintendo. And like the reason I kind of even thought about it is because, Dan, you're talking about draw distance. And I feel like, not saying this necessarily has anything exactly to do with it, you would know better than I would, but from my limited experience in game design when I took it in college, obviously the less intensive the graphics, the more you can do with draw distance, because it's, you know, it's less, you're less worrying about polygons and stuff like that. It can render more at one time. And I feel like their use of simple effects really adds, like allows them, like kind of allows them to do stuff like that. Maybe that's not the sole reason, but I do think it would help. So Cosmo, if you don't mind, could you kind of go into that video a little bit?
Yeah. So basically it's diving into, how does Galaxy 2 get such good water effects? Because if there's one thing that it does pretty well, and same thing with Sunshine, is just like the water in this game looks really good, still ages really well. And they use the beginning of Slimy Spring Galaxy as an example, where you got like this, they got water pools, and then you have like a cascading effect over some cliffs. And they show how they took like one basic texture, and they're doing something pretty simple with it. So it's like, imagine you got like this square texture in front of you, and then you can kind of change the distortion of the texture a little bit, and they kind of make it distortion, and they kind of cycle between a few of them to make it look like it's kind of going back and forth. But then at the same time, they also scroll the texture in different directions while they're putting the wavy effect over a texture that's scrolling. If you just imagine, probably, you know, link in the video is the best thing, but it's like a scrolling texture, and then it got this wavy effect on top of it. If you look at it from a distance, it really does look like that's just a pool of water. And what they did here is they did multiple layers of that, so different transparencies, so slightly different textures, but basically all of them are just moving in different directions and waving, and to varying degrees. And once you apply those effects to different surfaces, it really does look like, you know, cascading waterfall or just a barely moving pool of water. And that simple effect they probably apply to a bunch of other textures that I'm not aware of, but definitely to these underwater galaxies where you want to have that underwater feel where everything around is a little more wavy. That's actually a pretty basic effect that they're applying there.
I was just so like those videos you sent me, dude. I used the other one for the Galaxy 1 episode, and I wasn't sure if I was going to find a way to incorporate something so granular as like texture design into an episode. But I when we were started talking, when Dan, you mentioned the draw distance, do you now, basically, I want to know if I'm completely off base with this. I know simple textures like what Cosmo described aren't the sole reason for being able to do technical marvels like this on the Wii, but would you agree that it has something to do with it?
I mean, a little. And right, and this is an intentional design decision that goes way back, but especially just because I've been focused on it so much, the N64 and the technical powers but limitations that SGI hardware had, in the need to kind of refine your process and design simply in a way that still has impact, because you can't just lean on a lot of post-processing and like really dense models with a lot of polys on them to kind of do your presentation. You have to try to find ways that you can, you know, from a cost-effective standpoint, that you can get, you know, good effects. And whether that is just one or two simple layers, like he said, with transparency, or a nice, well-executed texture that you're performing some sort of either, you know, interpolation in layers, or just even transparency and shifting, you know, some transforming of those layers to kind of create that. That's going to be a way less system-intensive thing that you can do than trying to, say, actually have geometry at play, or firing up like particle effects or anything that's going to be potentially more expensive and harder to kind of capture. So it is kind of making the most out of limited resources. And that's something that we've always kind of been going into this game, especially older hardware, where we just had such limited resources. And you really, the more you could squeeze out of the hardware, the better. We were still kind of at that point, and especially the Nintendo Wii was not exactly known as being this powerhouse system, right? That was the point at which everyone kind of realized, like, oh, Nintendo decided they really don't want to compete. You know, they don't want to be state-of-the-art hardware and compete on that end. And to this day, those decisions seem to have paid off in spades for them. But it also means that your designers, right, have to take that into account and work with that. And nobody really has mastered that, you know, quite as well as obviously Nintendo's as first party developers.
I mean, like, Galaxy 1 and 2 still look great. Like, it's really, like you said, it's no one has quite mastered that type of, no one has quite mastered being able to do stuff like that, like Nintendo. And the fact that this game still looks and holds up, like plays well, looks good to this day, is just a testament to what they do. It really is impressive. One other thing I want to talk about with the game, with the design style, Miyamoto's overall design philosophy, from what I read in this Awada S, was that you have to create both resonance and a sense of the unusual. And I thought that was a really cool way to think about game design, in the sense that, like, if everything's predictable, you're going to get bored. So you always have to have some sense of the unusual, which I think Mario always has in spades. There's always some, whether it's a goofy idea or just something visually interesting to look at, there's always something fun to something unusual in a Mario game. And Koizumi ended up talking about what he realized in this game is that your objective in a Mario game isn't necessarily to tell a story, but it's to create a tool. And what he meant by that is it's a tool for the players to be able to be creative in Mario's world. Like, you know, it'll start off with, they talked in the interview about how if you play guitar, you know, the first couple levels, it's like you strumming one string. And as you progress through the game, you start strumming more strings, quote unquote, like if you were playing the guitar. And so the idea is that the game is like a guitar, you know, like as you progress through the game, you become, it's a tool that you can get better at. And so if you're really good at the game, you can do some crazy things, even in the early levels of Mario Galaxy 2. So I really like that design philosophy, though, of just considering the game as a tool as opposed to an engine to tell a story.
Yeah, I think that's what also led it to be so creative with its galaxies, and that basically you're not it's like you're not really limiting yourself to this thing or the other. You're just having a ton of different ideas. You're throwing anything at the wall, and for Galaxy 2, most of it's stuck. Like Chompwork's galaxy, like who would have thought of that? You know, like that idea of the rolling chain chomp heads, and you gotta micromanage them. I mean, that's just like, yeah. Once again, as they're saying, this is unusual, but you know, it works though.
And even with just some of the additions of some of the new things they brought in, like to that added that little bit of intrigue, whether it's Rock Mario, where you get a rock mushroom, you roll around as a ball, or even like I love the cloud flower, like that is so fun too.
People love the everyone loves the cloud. Why is this the only game the cloud is featured? It's a beloved power up.
They did talk about that a little bit because it gives the player almost too much freedom, which is why they like only limit it to three clouds per power up, which makes sense because if it was unlimited, you could just keep going up above the geometry of the level and just go
Yeah,
out of bounds.
I adore Super Mario World. The cape breaks that game so badly.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Especially if you get good with it, which it can be a little bit tough, but if you get good with it. So yeah, some of the new power-ups in this, like we mentioned, Cloud Flower and Rock Mushroom. There's also the returning power-ups are the Fire Flower, the Bee Mushroom, obviously the Invincibility Rainbow Star, the Boo Mushroom, and the Spring Mushroom. But of course, the biggest addition to this game is Yoshi. What are your guys' thoughts on Yoshi? Dan, what about you? What are your thoughts of the addition to Yoshi in this game?
This could have gone so badly. Yoshi is so much fun to play, but my initial expectation is, all right, you know, you're already kind of getting used to controlling Mario, or I was, because again, I played Galaxy 2 first, and dealing with the gravity in this unique space, and it could have been so easy to mess this up. If you had to try to face Yoshi to use Yoshi's tongue, but then just using the little targeting dot, you know, that Yoshi tongue dot with the Wiimote, instantly it's such a different version of Yoshi as an accessory. You feel so empowered when you have Yoshi to defend yourself, especially if you don't have a second player throwing stars on your behalf. It is really great. And they tie old stuff back into it. You get a blue and a yellow and a red Yoshi, but this time it's because they have Yoshi specific power-ups, which then lets them get creative with the level design even more and do things that are kind of based around utilizing those Yoshi power-ups. He's a joy in this game. I love the Yoshi stages.
What about you, Cosmo? Your thoughts on Yoshi?
Pretty much the exact same things what Dan said. Yeah, it could have gone really badly, but it's just an absolutely genius idea for them to use the pointer as a tongue because, like, yeah, you don't have to orient yourself and stick your tongue out or what Sunshine did, where you're vomiting up stuff and you got to vomit in the right direction, everything. Like here, you know, you're just it's just as easy as picking up star bits, and they're able to design the levels with that. Like what was it? Those floating things that he can kind of hook with his tongue and then fly
The little
upwards.
flowers.
Yeah, those little flowers, exactly. Yeah, like they really designed the environments really well around that. And same thing with the bosses as well. You know, use a tongue to aim. And I did notice that when you do like eat something up and then you're about to shoot at something, the cursor turns into a little arrow, like a 3D arrow, and you can kind of see where you're pointing. And that's also just like one those little touches, you know, that's everything. And then of course, all those power-ups that you give him, like those are like all the levels that are designed around those are also really, really well done. Especially like the one where he has like the hot pepper. That one is also it's so well designed because it's very incidental. Like you can't really apply it to anywhere else, but the levels that it's in, like, I mean, we're probably gonna talk about the final stage, the masterpiece of the final stage, but just yeah, that stage has so many examples of like how you can use those very, very specific Yoshi power-ups in specific ways, but still, you know, they feel like you're fulfilling something. You know, you're not. It's not like oh, it's there to be there. You know, it's a good balance.
I also think something we haven't brought up in terms of power-ups is the because it's not really considered a power-up as much as it's considered more of an item, and that is the drill head thing. whatever you want to call it, that was added because Miyamoto was like, well, what if Mario could, you know, travel through the planets? Because, you know, before he could only walk around the outside. What if he could travel through the planets? And that, once they figured that out, that added a whole bunch of cool, you know, design ideas where, you know, there were some towers you couldn't reach, but if you ran to the other side of the planet, you could drill straight through to the top of this unreachably tall tower. Additionally, there is some worlds where it's just like a rectangle or a square. So when you drill through to the other side, you're actually drilling through like other rooms and stuff like that. And you can find some really interesting things there. But the problem is that gravity, this is early on in the game, but it's like a rectangle. And while you're in the rectangle, like inside of it, it only goes down, like gravity only travels in one direction. And then you're on the outside, you cling to it like it's a planet, like there's gravity clinging to it on all sides. So it's a really weird way to, like, it makes sense, but it's still very confusing at the same time. And I talked about it in the previous episode, with how they programmed the gravity fields. And now after learning about how they programmed the gravity fields in Galaxy 1, it just makes me so confused how they're doing it in this one. Like I can kind of picture it, but it's still just such a unique idea. And I'm trying to actually think of the, what is it, the level that it was called, but I can't quite remember. What are your guys' thoughts on the drill, though?
The drill is, and I'll be brief here, the drill is just one of so many ways that they just got really, really flexibly minded with the level design. And I could rave about the level design in this game for ages. You know, not just getting inside the planet and swimming around inside, because Mario likes to have those little consolidated one room puzzles or fun things sometimes, or getting you from one place to a very distant place. Like you said, you can traverse a large planet or planetoid just by finding that one little dirt spot that you're supposed to get to with the drill, and then kind of using that almost as a gate to another area. But it's just one of a number of kind of devices that they use to really just try to get more out of this gravity design, more out of the idea that you're working with these limited spaces, these almost like jungle gyms that you're kind of playing on, and how to try to kind of stretch those to their absolute design limits time and time again.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, that's really what it is. It's enabling more flexible level design. You can, like, once again, I'm thinking of the final stage where they got this, like, it's almost like a cylinder, and then you got the Banzai bills that are coming at you, and you have to make your way closer to the end of the other side of the cylinder, but then you got these Banzai bills coming at you, so you got to drill to the other side, and so you're going back and forth with that. Like, that kind of clever design is only possible with such a power-up that lets you just go directly to the other end. And also, there's another level where you're drilling, and then they got, like, angled, like, hard edges, and then Mario bounces off of them at a different angle. And it's like you got to get to the end, but then you're just bouncing off and trying to kind of plan ahead how you're going to do things. Like, yeah, that can only happen with such a power up.
Well, since we're talking about level design anyway, Dan, you said that you could gush about the level design in this game. I have beaten this game, but I did not have a chance to completely replay it for this episode because I've been prepping for other Mario Month episodes. But I played probably about the first five or six galaxies in this. So as much as I love this game and can talk pretty well about the first couple, it's going to be hard for me to really discuss the design of this. So Dan, if you have any thoughts that you want to go into with the level design and game design of this, feel free, dive in.
Yeah, sure. So the pacing in Galaxy 2 follows a fairly predictable design at first, which is you have your initial galaxies where you learn to play the game, you find Yoshi, you get the clouds for the first time, you get the rock for the first time, and a lot of those happen in like the first dozen or so galaxies where you're introduced to most of what's new, the basic ideas of the game you're playing. and you do, you know, one or two stars, you know, in each of these. And then you have the prankster comets, and then way, way, way later you have the green stars. But the design of each stage accommodates multiple levels of skill, because the game takes into consideration this idea of going forward, going back, building in additional challenges, because you're going through and doing these different things. Later on, it's streamlined a little bit in Odyssey, and you have sort of the convenience and the nicety of the moon collection, where you can kind of do as much as you're capable of doing based on what you've collected and what you've got, and some things you will have to backtrack and pick up. But in Galaxy 2, you really do kind of go to the world, get a star, go to the world, get a star, and move on in a pace, in a way that you are getting more and more proficient with the controls and the design and the power-ups, so that by the time you get to your second or third trip to Tall Trunk Galaxy, or you've really, like me, the one thing that was always tough for me was the flip jumps, the things where it goes from like the red to the blue. Because unlike everything else you do, this is the one thing where you've taught yourself and kind of trained yourself that, like, that extra little spin while you're jumping is your savior, right? That's you can kind of stabilize yourself, slow yourself down, try to aim for a platform. And now you're kind of forcing yourself to remember that every time you do that, you're flipping the two different colored platforms, mm-hmm. which one's up and down. And that's a fun little mind bend. But they really just go to such great lengths, creativity wise. Some of the ones I remember standing out for me, less the nostalgic ones, which I love. It's great to hear the callbacks, and I'll go back to the music later because there's so many great revisions of old songs. But there are levels that have these just brand new takes, like Boo Moon. It has that top down part where you are in a Boo level, and Boo levels you can always get really creative with. But there's this added sense of this sort of bizarre tension. There's a little bit of this in Mario 64 in like the piano room and some other parts of the Boo level. But just mm-hmm. having that top down claustrophobic roaming around was really cool. I think it's Clockwork something, one of the later levels. I think it's in World 6. Clockwork or Clock World, like, it has really, really clever machinations where the world is kind of rotating and you're maneuvering within it. And it's not just that you're kind of going around the world, but the world is now also moving and playing in ways around you that really makes the platforming. It's kind of that test where let's really make sure that you've got this platforming refined in a way that's very, it never feels like you are being aha'd or gotcha'd, right? You can kind of see things as they're happening. They give you the usual design pattern of see something happening in a way that you can witness it without being victim to it, then mm-hmm. allow you to try to cross that thing, then have you cross that thing with a slight variance, and then cross that thing with another slight variance or a combination of variances. There's just that well-designed taking the idea and putting it through its permutations that you get time and time again. I don't know if you remember, have you written down, there's what, like 50 worlds? Or worlds, there's like 50 galaxies or something.
There's 49 galaxies from what I can see here. Okay. I'm actually on, I have the wiki open just for like quick reference for when, you know, like you're mentioning Clockwork Ruin, so I was trying to get a visual on that to put the image back in my head. But yeah, so there's about like 49, maybe 50 if I'm not reading all of them on the wiki here.
But yeah, it just It's so, I want to say refreshing, because it is a very, they are common design patterns, or the things we're encouraged. They're best practices, if you want to use the sort of the technical software design concept there. But they're just really, really well executed. There's very few examples I can think of in my head where I felt like the design of the stages did not lend itself towards either getting you better at playing the game or letting you get playful with what the game has already taught you. The green stars might be the sole exception to that, but that's kind of a whole different thing. We can talk New Game Plus later.
So from what I'm kind of getting is like it does a really good job of almost masking that it's teaching you things without like, I think it, like you said, it's best practice or best practice. Is that what you said? Sorry. Best practice. Yeah. Like I almost feel like, you know, a game is well designed when maybe you don't even notice the best practices are being used. Like, I know you pointed that out, Dan, but you're also a professor of game design. So like for the layman, I almost want, like, there's something that's not necessarily infuriating, but it's, you know, you learn something new and usually there's like some type of text box, like, oh, you now have this ability to do this. And you can think of like any open world PlayStation game right now, you know, like, you have this new item. And I'm not trying to throw shade at those either. It's like, I love a lot of those open world PlayStation games, but like with this, the way the game teaches you different things is just by the natural slow progression of ramping up the challenge and giving you different challenges that steadily test your skill on something. So by when you get to the end of the game, while something still may be challenging, it never feels like it's out of your reach. It never feels like it's out of your grasp.
Yeah. Quick sidebar.
Yeah.
Just consider that this game constantly gets referred to by people. You mentioned Super Mario Galaxy 1.5, right? This so often gets referred to as so similar to the previous one in a way that people are like, oh, well, Mario 1 to Mario 2 was such an innovation, or then Mario 64 or Mario Sunshine, or, you know, they talk about how these Mario games take these leaps and that it was such a small leap from Galaxy to Galaxy 2. Well, by that logic, it would have been very easy for a less conscious developer to assume skill or knowledge of their players that Galaxy 2 respectfully doesn't. Galaxy 2, it's so familiar and it plays itself as this retelling, this storybook retelling of something that in theory, a lot of its players have already played. And yet it still takes its time and its paces to make sure that anyone who hasn't played it gets comfortable with it. Anyone that hasn't played it in a while gets reacclimated to it. And that anyone who is familiar with the first one, but not necessarily second, gets an opportunity to really feel and understand that the differences, not so much in level design, but really in sort of the mechanics of play.
That's always been something they talked about in the Iwata S for both this game as well as Galaxy 1, that they were always very conscious of trying to make sure that the game was accessible for new players. And I really think there's something to be said for when a game is so well designed that you get to the end of the game and you are doing things where, like, if you were watching someone else play the game at the section you are at, you'd be amazed at how smooth they're doing some of the tricks and some of the moves and some of the platforming. I think an example I always like to give when I suggest this game to people are the Ori games, Ori in the Blind Forest and Ori in the Will of the Wisps, where when I think actually, and this is a credit to Mario games, you can jump in, and even on the last level, while they may be difficult, you're able to kind of pick it right back up and kind of get a decent grasp of like how to control Mario again, versus Ori. Like, it's hard to go into the end level of that game because it's just so brutally difficult. But I remember playing those games, and by the time if you play it all the way through, you get so accustomed to the mechanics that you're doing like some of these crazy platforming tricks that I like it's muscle memory. It's the strangest sensation where like I'm doing these tricks that I've for levels that I've never seen before or areas that I've never seen before. And the muscle memory just has me doing that, not flawlessly, but pretty damn well. And I feel like there is a good element of that in Mario Galaxy 2. And just Mario games in general, where they make it easy enough for new players to come in and not be completely overwhelmed. But then also, like, by the end of the game, they've taught you so much without you realizing it that you have muscle memory without realizing you have muscle memory, which is a really cool, I don't know, that's a really cool sensation. So before we move on, I before we kind of talk about some of the green stars and other stuff, Cosmo, you wanted to talk a bit about the final level of this game. I know you mentioned it briefly about like the flame cylinder and how you use the drill to go from one side to the other, but let's kind of talk about the final level of this. And I actually did watch even though I couldn't completely re-beat it for this episode, I did watch the final boss of Bowser. But like the final area, what do you got to say about it?
Yeah, I think it's just a masterful a good combination of everything you have experienced in this game up to that point. Like, it's just crazy to think that they're like the entire game, they're throwing so many different power-ups and gimmicks at you. And then when they all put together in the final level, it doesn't really feel like, oh crap, I haven't experienced this power-up in like, I don't know, 2-3, you know, worlds, right? Like when they put it all together, it just works. So like in the beginning, you have that, that's like a, it's like a floating dandelion, and you're kind of cascading down this fiery waterfall area. So that's already something from that Cloudy Court galaxy. And then you pick up the drill, and then you drill, and they go down the opposite side, and all of a sudden you're on that cylinder that I talked about before. So that's already using the drill. And all of a sudden now you're in this 2D section, and you're going up and down these platforms also on this giant cylinder, but also kind of brings back those 2D areas that you had gone to before. And then you think, all right, you know, maybe they might do something like that Flipside Galaxy. No, they put the cloud mushroom in there. And now you're falling down this cylinder with the cloud mushroom with these fans that are now pushing you around inside this big cylinder area. And this is all still in 2D as well. So that's already another way for them to spice it up. And then they give you Yoshi. And then now you're going across a bunch of platforms with Yoshi, with the flowers. And then you're fighting the Hammer Bros with Yoshi. And you had already fought these Hammer Bros in the beginning. Then they have this area with these waterfalls that are kind of coming on both sides, and they give you the pepper power-ups. So then Yoshi's running through that. And it's just, I mean, the level just goes on and on. And they just basically throw all of these different things at you, but then they still make the level feel pretty cohesive. And it's just, you're making your way up towards this fortress, but they're just combining all of these gimmicks together. It's so fluid. It's not like you're going from section to section. And that's what I think is just so amazing. And the music. Music's like, God, one of my favorite tracks of all time. It's just, it has no right to be that dramatic.
I mean, they really went, both this game and Galaxy 1, considering that they were the first orchestrated Mario games. Obviously, Galaxy 1 was the first, but the music in both of these games is some of the best out there. And before we kind of dive into the music as well, the final boss, I actually really like the mechanics in that, how like Bowser shoots up these tiny little planets that you then have to jump on and then pound on, like do a ground pound, so that way you can launch them at him, but you have to aim at them correctly, especially when you, after you think you've beaten Bowser and he kind of comes back for one final thing, you actually have to be careful because you have to aim the planets that you're kind of ground pounding on at the right angle. It's almost like pool or billiards, like where you have to hit Bowser at the right spot, because if you hit his shell, it doesn't do any damage and you're looking at him from almost the side at times. Really, I really do enjoy the final boss. I think it's a really fun mechanic. It really shows exactly what the Galaxy games are. Like, you're literally running around the tiniest little planets and having to bounce, like, you know, just using the physics of this gravity-based world to your advantage. It's a lot of fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then also the mechanic of you hitting or ground pounding those things toward him, that's almost like a repeat of a previous mechanic, because I think, if I remember correctly, you got these doors and you got these locks on them before you even enter Bowser, and you have to do those. Yeah, you have to do it to those locks. That's another like really subtle, it's almost like a precursor to what you're about to do in these boss fights against them. So they thought out everything in this game. It's just crazy.
Yeah, those lava levels, they have those doors, and they're basically training you on how to attack. And by the time you get in there, you recognize the same object and go, okay, so that's what I'm supposed to do.
And that's exactly I love it when games can do that, where it becomes, like I said, it's that muscle memory. You look at something, you're like, oh, I know how to do this. It becomes an instinctual thing. So Dan, you mentioned the green stars, kind of like the the prankster comets type of thing, right?
Well, there's two. So there's the prankster comets. You get these coins throughout the levels, and those spawn the prankster comets, and those are additional stars that you can go back and collect from the levels in your journey towards 120. And those are variances of the levels where You have to do things like collect purple coins. You have to run through the levels, then they're timed levels. And those are a lot of fun because they give you short timer windows, but there's like time that you can collect while you're mm-hmm. going through the levels. So those are just, you know, those variances on those levels that you can go through again. The green comets are, once you have completed the entire game and gotten 120 stars, the world is repopulated with these green stars. And the green stars are weird and a little different. And I guess I'll wander into a couple of my critiques, I guess, of Galaxy 2 at this point. The first, before we get too far off onto it, because we were talking about the boss design, not to be too much of a wet blanket here, but the game Galaxy 2 is definitely a little harder than Galaxy 1. And they really, you are very capable and they really do train you up in being able to be Mario, but they also really test you in a lot of ways. The bosses, surprisingly, are way less challenging, I think, than I'd expect. I mean, some of the Bowser Jr., like the pageantry or the grandiosity of him, like his giant robot and stuff, and even that last fight with Bowser, they do a great job of the presentation of it all, but they are remarkably simple fights, and they're not terribly challenging. The only one I remember struggling with a little was the that long dragon that kind of wraps around the planet and eats through it. Because you had to attack the sides, and sometimes I'd have a little trouble spatial reasoning, like if I was close enough to spin and hit the weak points on him. But by and large, the boss fights I remember for me were a standout as being weirdly easier than the game. It didn't bother me. It wasn't a big problem, but it was just kind of one of those things where I felt like it was a rare moment of the two things not feeling quite in line. If that was a minor quibble, the green stars are, I don't want to say they're padding, because they're not padding, but they are not nearly as cleverly integrated into the game design as the original 120 run. By the time you're doing the green stars, you really, you know, say mastery, but you have a really good grasp of how to handle Mario. Mm-hmm. But all you're really left to do is kind of explore and pick up clues or dig into areas of these stages you may not have gone to before. There's an audio cue for finding them. But as somebody who has hearing issues in one ear, that doesn't make it super easy. But also, it's not enough, right? Like kind of wandering the stage looking for these unique or interesting places they can stash these green stars. There was an opportunity to do a little more. There may have been memory limitations, time limitations, scope limitations to the design. When you're asking somebody to do another 120 stars plus mm-hmm. the two beyond that for Grandmaster Galaxy, you know, that's probably, it may be a bridge too far to say, like, can't we have a similar level of attention to detail for the acquisition of those? Because they really are for people who are just, you've beaten the game, but you can't get enough of it and you want to keep going. I didn't get that sense of like, I have to get to 242 when I played Galaxy 2. Getting to 120 stars was itself quite satisfying. That's not to say I don't love the game and I could listen to the soundtrack for you know, a whole night of working. And those who want to will certainly enjoy getting there. But it is certainly a lot more tedium than I'm used to in a Mario game.
Oh, yeah. Like, the placement of some of those green stars is just kind of crazy. Like, a lot of them are like suicide jumps, basically. Like, they're just over the bottomless plate. You just got to long jump your way there, do one, maybe twirl, and hopefully you touch it. It's like, yeah, some of them, it's almost like you need a guide for some of them. Like, I get the audio cue thing, but yeah, for me as well, it's just, that still wasn't too much of help with some levels, especially where it is super duper out of your way and it's just over a bottomless pit. Like, how am I going to know it's there? How am I going to look there? Kind of the thing.
I always personally found, like, I always liked the idea of like the challenge stars, like whether it's the prankster comets or just like these type other extra collectibles type of thing. But like, I always found them kind of boring. Like it was, I shouldn't say boring because the challenge was always fun, but I think the reason I'm kind of with you on this, Dan, with especially with the green stars, is usually Now, like, correct me, I don't remember, when do the green stars first appear? Is it after you beat the game, or is it while you're playing it through your first run? I'm completely blanking on this.
I don't think they appear, and I'd have to look it up myself, I don't think they appear until you've beaten Bowser the first time. I don't think you have to get to, you might have to get to 120 stars. I don't remember if you have to get to 120 before they appear.
I think you have to get to 120. I think it's after, yeah.
Yeah, it's definitely one of those things where, like, it's at the what seems like the end of the game. They kind of drop this whole new game on you, but the new game really isn't a new game. It's half of a new game at best, in terms of they expect you to collect 120 things, but the design is a lot simpler in terms of just go into level, poke around, see if you can rotate the camera, look, try to get some clues or ideas of where, now that you've played through 120 stars worth of Super Mario Galaxy 2, maybe you have a little better idea of where things might be hidden, more attention to detail for design. But yeah, seriously, some of these are just really obscure, off the beaten path. Like, if you don't know, you may never know. Asking around on the school, you're like, where's the green star in this level? I've been looking around for like a week and I can't find it. This is the stuff that GameFAQs exists for, truthfully. You know, these are the ones where you go, like, it's lost the fun factor of trying to dig out the location. I enjoy going to the worlds. I enjoy playing around here. There are a couple times where you can get exasperated enough to be like, just tell me where it is.
And for me, like, the reason I was saying some of these aren't my favorite is it's not, like, this is very much something where it's like, I don't know if it's, I wouldn't say it's like bad design. It's just not my cup of tea, if that makes sense. Because it's all purely optional, a lot of it. Well, pretty much, like, you don't need to get the original 120 stars, and likewise, you don't need to get the repeat 120 green stars. Like, it's not necessary. It's all just, if you really like this game and you want to explore more of these worlds, this is for you. And I admire that, but I find so little fun in doing that. Even in the original Galaxy, it would always actually irk me if, because I guess I'm very, I don't know, maybe list oriented is might be the right term, where, you know, like, if you're in in Galaxy 1, for example, I would unlock, you know, another section of the observatory, and then I would go to those galaxies and start exploring. And after I'd beat a galaxy, all of a sudden I would get a notification, you know, it would zoom back into a previous area that I was in, you know, a different part of the observatory, and like, hey, there's a prankster comet over here. I'm like, I don't want to go all the way back over there just to get a star for a level that I already beat. It always felt so out of the way. And to be clear, that's not necessarily me criticizing the design of it. It's just, it's not my favorite thing. I always want to be like, I'm here right now. I want to do this. And then I want to move on. I don't want to have to stop and backtrack for the sake of backtracking. Like in Metroidvanias, you backtrack generally to either get to a new spot that you couldn't before or get a new power up that you couldn't get before. And this, it's just to get another power star, which is fine, but it's like your reward for backtracking is a different challenge, which is fun. It's a cool idea, but for me, it's almost laziness on my behalf, where I'm like, I don't feel like doing this.
Yeah. And they do, I think they realize that, because there are little refinements in Galaxy 2. Part of it is getting rid of the hub world and switching to the map. And part of it is the way that the map presents what's there. They're trying to take some of that extra time out, right? So instead of leaving the world, going to the other side of the observatory and going into the world that way, you know, it's a 5-second zoom back out to the map, swing over a world or two, drop in to the level that you're going to go into. It, you know, 15 or 30 seconds or a minute or two here or there doesn't make a big difference once, but it makes a big difference if you're talking about like 240 times that you're going into these worlds. One of my favorite game designers is Terry Kavanagh. I may have mentioned him before. And I think something that he realized is he's made some very challenging games, or for some very challenging moments in games, like Veni Vidi Vici in VVVVVV, or just Super Hexagon in general. But I think he realizes there's a difference between challenge and difficulty and the time spent doing the thing that is not challenging, difficult, or interesting. If you have a really hard jump to clear, you'll try it and it can be frustrating. But what's more frustrating is the 15 to 30 seconds to get back to that thing you were trying to do. In yes. his games, the challenging thing is there, but he puts no, absolutely no barrier between trying it and then trying it again. In VVV, VVV, there's checkpoints in almost every room. So you're trying that difficult yes. thing over and over and over again instantly. In Super Hexagon, it's like you're dead, and then less than a second later, you've hit the button and you're playing again. And because that he takes away those added frustrations and says, just try to do the challenge, keep practicing. I don't care if your iterations between trials are nice and small windows, just keep doing it until you're comfortable with it. Games recognizing where they can shave busy work out of the game, especially in a day and age where everything is about hours and engagement and trying to get people to play for as long as they possibly can. It's such a user-friendly design pattern to design something in a way where you are not forcing the player to do the same thing over and over again if it isn't something they enjoy or it isn't contributing toward their experience.
That you literally described might be all of the issues I have with Dark Souls. I went on a rant about this and either I forget where, but basically that was the reason I tried out Dark Souls and I quit playing it is because I got stuck on a boss and I would have to spend, I did end up beating the boss, but I would have to spend 10 to 15 minutes to fight my way back to the boss on areas that I already beat, already cleared out. And it was, I was more annoyed. I didn't mind dying, but it was just, I would take so long. I couldn't, it was almost impossible to practice on the boss because I would spend more time. I think I spent more time just traversing down two hallways because I can't run past all the enemies in it than I did actually fighting the boss. And that's not fun to me. And I yeah. kind of respect that. I agree with you on that design standpoint. And actually, I've never beaten VVVV or the letter V six times or whatever it's called. But I've played it a bunch. And it's the same thing. One of the same reasons I love Celeste is because when you die, it's a very quick respawn. You still see all the challenge right in front of you. So are there any other things you guys want to talk about before we go into the soundtrack and music for this game?
You're talking about that. Why would I possibly suggest something else when we can talk about the music in this game?
I have no, I wanted to make sure we didn't miss anything that you guys wanted to cover, but we can dive right in. Or Cosmo, is there anything you want to talk about before we go into the music?
Well, not really. No, I mean, I think we pretty much hit everything. I just made this random note here on my notes that I noticed that there are a lot more blue sky boxes than night sky boxes. Super random, but I just kind of noticed, like, huh, you know, like Galaxy 1, you really felt like you're in space here. They're really throwing you in these, you know, blue sky sunset areas rather than just being pitch black. I don't know if that's just a random detail.
Yeah, that was Miyamoto's directive.
Yeah, it really is like we recognize this game is taking place in galaxy worlds or whatever, but it's still just a Mario game. We have our sand world and our ice world and our fire world and our boo levels and all of those familiar skyboxes and texture sets. And it really is there's just a commitment to making this more and more Mario-esque.
I also, in just thinking of notes that I didn't have a chance to really bring up in any other context, I should have brought it up when we were talking about Yoshi. I mean, in video games, there's always a lot of talk when you're designing about it, or when you're designing a game, like what is your verb set? You know, like what are you giving the player? What abilities are you giving the player? Or what is like the, you know, Mario's verb set is generally like his main verb is jump, you know,
right.
i.e. Jumpman. So the verb set for, or the verb that defined Yoshi's usage was eating. And that really makes a lot of sense. I obviously, you mentioned before, Cosmo, about how you can aim the joy, not the Joy-Con. We're not playing on the Switch. The Wiimote, yet. We're aiming the Wiimote at the at what the target is, and then you can shoot Yoshi's tongue out at it. But then you also use it for when, you know, swinging on the flowers, and you know he eats enemies and then poops out star bits, which I mean, what happened to the eggs like from Yoshi's Island? I'm just saying. It's a really, I totally forgot to bring this up with Yoshi as well. You guys were talking about how like Yoshi could have gone very wrong. I agree with you. I think the one thing that they say it in the Iwata ass thing, how they wanted players to feel empowered with Yoshi. I actually didn't. Like, Yoshi was nice because you could take that extra hit. You could eat enemies that Mario couldn't normally do anything to. And so I didn't mind that, but I found a lot less flexibility in terms of some of the platforming movement. So like, if you needed any, like there was a couple moments where I would die because I was riding on Yoshi, not because I had like, so if I needed that extra jump, if you shake the Wiimote, Yoshi will, you know, shake his head, but it doesn't cause that momentary pause, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, so he's got a flutter jump, which will give you, it's a good reprieve from vertical, yes. Right? It kind of slows your vertical descent, but it doesn't have the effect of Mario spin where it's really kind of controlling your position in all three directions, you know, X, Y, Z position kind of stabilizes a lot better with that. Whereas with Yoshi's flutter jump, it's kind of helping you control your height, but not a lot else.
And also, up until that point, and if you've played Mario Galaxy 1, you have almost muscle memory that if you want to control your jump, you shake the Wiimote or the nunchuck. But you can't do that with Yoshi. You have to hit the jump button again to do his little flutter jump, which is fine, but it's like you've been conditioned to do one thing, and now when you have, and it makes sense, like Yoshi is a different character and the gameplay mechanics are going to be different. I just personally found it a little difficult for myself with that adjustment. Everything else that Yoshi does is really fun, but I personally found that hard to manage, and I don't know why. It was a weird thing that I just had a hard time adjusting to.
No, it's a fair point.
So let's go into the music. I'm always bad at describing music, but I at least wanted to, we talked about it briefly in the Mario Galaxy 1 episode, so we should really shout it out, of course, again here in Mario Galaxy 2. Once again, the soundtrack is fantastic. I'd like to know both of your guys' thoughts. Cosmo, we're going to start off with you. What are your thoughts on the soundtrack?
Phenomenal. That's the only way I can describe it. It's just phenomenal. Like it's almost like I wouldn't say have a greater emphasis on like an orchestrated soundtrack, but I just noticed that some jingles and tracks that are from Galaxy 1, they're now fully orchestrated rather than synthesized. Namely the Get Star jingle, da 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 da, that is now like fully orchestrated. I remember when I went back to Galaxy 1 after years of not playing it, I was used to the Galaxy 2 jingle, and I was like, huh, this feels really synthetic. And I was like, wait a minute, you know, Galaxy 2 actually orchestrated it. And people were pointing that out when 3D All-Stars came out, like the opening whatever title screen, they play the Get Star jingle, and it's from Galaxy 2. It's because it's a full orchestra, it's not the synthesized ones. People are like, mm-hmm. Galaxy 2 is not in it, yet you're using the star, you know, effect from it. But yeah, that's what I noticed. They definitely put a little thought into that. And also just not the music, but just how they incorporate the orchestra into other effects. I'm pretty sure this is in Galaxy 1 as well, but when you get close to the launch stars, like the music, like you can hear like a harp in the back, but the harp fits in with the music somehow. And then especially if you get into the launch star and you don't shake the Wii remote and you're just kind of just stuck floating in there, but you can hear that harp just kind of going back and forth in the background. And then you have a little harp jingle when you shoot off. But yeah, the Galaxy 2 is very good with its, I forget what to call it, like the music that evolves as you get deeper to the level, or like I think about the Fire and Ice Galaxy, how it's the same track, but then it kind of gets different when you're in the different areas. It's very, very good at that.
Yeah, dynamic music. Scoring is,
there yeah. There you go, yeah, dynamic scoring, exactly. Yeah, that's what it's really good at, but then also just, I mean, I could name off the whole soundtrack right now, but there are so many great tracks.
Yeah, it's funny. We were actually talking about dynamic scoring. We had a panel at MAGFest a little time ago talking with Dave Gilbert and Francisco Gonzalez, who are both adventure game designers. Mm-hmm. And Francisco, in his games, has this dynamic scoring system where he's kind of writing a song. And the little things like when you go into a building, dropping one or two instruments from the song so that it sounds a little more muted, right? Because you're not hearing... It's the impression of you're not out on the busy city street. Now you're inside, say, a bank, and it's a quieter thing. You're still hearing the same song, but maybe you're hearing just like some of the percussion and a little bit of like the woodwinds part of it. That it has that tone of being inside a bank, but you're still hearing it. And then you kind of come back outside and the full orchestration just naturally picks up where the original song left off because these things are running in parallel in the background. And it's just kind of creatively panning from one track to another. You know, in a game like Galaxy 2, you know, you can have these increased effects or buildups where the song has additional orchestration or additional, you know, notes or sounds, and just kind of dynamically bring these things in or pull these things out as necessary, right? Like we've all seen where you go underwater and you kind of like pull some of the treble out of the sound a little bit, or pull some of the instruments out, right, to give that sense of being underwater. Music and sound is just such a powerful tool for immersion, for bringing you into experiences. And Galaxy, honestly, both Galaxy and Galaxy 2 do a really good job of doing that. I think where Galaxy 2 shined for me, pun absolutely intended, is that Galaxy 2 really, in what was, you said, you know, I don't want to say immersion, you were talking about how the game needed to resonate. Galaxy 2's soundtrack is a brilliant mixture of taking themes, sounds, songs from previous games and original tracks that they have written for this game, with a really good balance to that, both from galaxy to galaxy and from, I don't know why they call it, so weird to me, galaxies are the individual levels, worlds are the collections of levels. It's a little backwards, whatever. but, you know, each of these spaces, they really do take care to kind of do a little of everything in each of them tonally.
I also really like, we were just talking about just kind of sound design as well. They, the fact that they have little sound effects coming out of the Wiimote too, when you do things, whether it's the, when you go through the star that you, I forget the name of, but you know, the stars that will shoot you off.
The launch stars.
Thank you. Every time you shake the Wiimote or when you get close to it, it comes out of the Wiimote, and some stuff like that. It's known as, it was kind of a joke at the time as an issue with the Wii, where the Wii was known to be gimmicky because of the motion controls, because of everything. But what Galaxy and the Galaxy games in general, and Galaxy 2, of course, did, was it never feels gimmicky. The motion controls don't feel gimmicky. The sounds coming from your controller don't feel gimmicky. It really much adds to the experience, and it kind of immerses you. It resonates with you. And I think another benefit of the music that resonates with you, I talked about it a bit on the Galaxy episode, and I want to bring it up again here. When they were composing the music for the first Galaxy game, it was originally going to be, it was a lot more quote unquote kiddie-ish. And the composer was trying to figure out like how to make it, like, was, you know, running this by Koji Kondo. I forget who did the music for the first game. I think it was Mahito Yokota. I'm not 100% certain. But I'll double check on that. Yes, sorry, I actually just looked it up. He did do the music for the first one. But when he was writing it, he would run it by Koji Kondo, and Kondo would say, like, no, this doesn't sound like Mario music. And he found out the reason is, it's like he was writing it to be a kid's music. And Kondo was like, no, Mario's cool. Like, write it as if Mario's cool. That's how you have to approach both, and they reference it even in the design as well for this game as well as the previous, that you have to approach it as, you know, Mario's cool. That has to be your mindset. And I think one of the reasons I love about this soundtrack, and I know I referenced the music or the song for the face ship, is that it's memorable. You know, like it has a melody, it has a hook, and that's something that, like, there's a reason why you know, like the original Mario song, everyone knows it. People like it, it evokes nostalgia in people immediately without even having to see the game. And when I hear the Galaxy soundtracks, it evokes that same emotion in me. And I didn't grow up with this game. This isn't like an emotion from from a perspective of nostalgia, but it's just so well written and it's so beautiful that when you hear it, you can't help but smile, and it reminds you of playing the game. And that's powerful. Not a lot of games are able to pull that off. And to be fair, a lot of games aren't necessarily shooting for that. They're going for more of a, you know, sound like immersion, like it's meant to help like bolster the gameplay versus stand out from the gameplay. But I think this game strikes a good balance where it doesn't ever feel like it's taking away from the game. It's not like you're noticing the music and that's making you not play the game. It's making you play the game differently versus this just, it blends very, very well. So I think you mentioned, Dan, about how like music, tying it back to their original thing of resonation, like having the game resonate with people. You nailed it. This music resonates with people. And I think it resonates with me, at least from a personal perspective. Like, I love this soundtrack, and it's something I said it before in the last episode, and I said again, it's inspired so many people. I actually shared with you, Cosmo, the Super Mercado Bros with their of Cosmic Proportions album, which was all Mario Galaxy inspired music, and it feels like something straight out of these games.
Yeah, it does. And also, to touch on the point you were talking about, stuff coming out of the Wii Remote, there's that Beat Block Galaxy. And the song does incorporate the Wii Remote because the beeps from those blocks, they come out of the Wii Remote. So I remember listening to the official OST, and I was listening to that Galaxy, and I felt like something was missing. And I realized, oh, wait a minute. You know,
It doesn't have the beeps.
It doesn't have the beeps, exactly. And that also happens with 3D World's official soundtrack. They don't include the beeps in that one, but that's different because here it was coming through the Wii Remote, but it felt so natural for it to come through the Wii Remote that I just thought it was part of, you know, what was on the TV and not what was coming through the remote. But yeah, that's just another example of just them combining those two seamlessly and not making it feel like, well, looks like we got this speaker on the Wii Remote. We got to figure out how to use it in some way.
Beep, beep, beep.
Oh, yeah.
It sticks with you.
It does.
And I think that is a good way for us to wrap up this episode. It resonates with us. This game has resonated with us, and I hope this episode has resonated with all of you. This was a lot of fun, guys. Thank you so much for joining me on this episode. Before we wrap this episode up, any final words and thoughts you want to say about Super Mario Galaxy 2? For sake of ease, so we're not stumbling and bumbling over each other. Cosmo, let's start off with you.
I don't really have much else to say. Everything I think about this game is pretty much here. It's one of my favorite games of all time. I can end on a hot take. I think that Sky Station Galaxy 2 is better than Sky Station Galaxy 1, the tracks. Just throw that out there. Now go start Flame Wars.
I like it. Ending with a hot take. Dan, what about you?
Gosh, I mean, it's a huge game. We definitely didn't cover everything. There's the little like cosmic clones that follow you around, and that being a cool variant of like a timing mechanic. This game also has simplify it or play the level for you if it's too challenging mechanic that, you know, if someone just kind of wants to get through it and see the original ending and they're really struggling, that's a really kind of neat thing. They don't count for completion, but the fact you can even get bronze stars is a nice thought. I'm sure there's other things we're forgetting. The blue Yoshi that inflates, that whistling sound is annoying. I didn't mention that. it's a blast of a game. If you haven't played it, go play it and come back and thank us later.
Yeah, I mean, and I feel like this has become a theme of my episodes where I feel like there's always, we get close to like an hour and a half mark. And then I'm like, man, there's so much more I wish we could have talked about. And especially like, I would have loved to have had time to completely replay this game. Like I really wish that, because I do love the Mario Galaxy games, and I just like Mario games in general, and I feel like there's always so much more we could talk about. And the fact that you mentioned the little shadow thing is an interesting timing mechanic. I forgot all about those. It's in the first game as well. It's such a fun, I think it's in the first game as well, but it's such a fun idea, and there's so many fun ideas included in this that we did not really get to explore, because and I think that really is one of the staples of Mario games in that they bring so many ideas to the table, and it's a staple of Nintendo in general. They bring a lot of ideas to the table, and they don't always use them all, or they don't use them all in to the fullest extent that they possibly could have, which isn't a criticism, because they almost always reuse it. And there's always so many inventive ideas. And Mario, I think it's funny. I said it on, I don't remember which episode. I'll repeat it here because I don't remember how long ago I said this. But I found the Mario games much later. Like I did not grow up with Mario. I didn't have, like, I was one of the few kids that had an N64, but not Mario 64. Right. I think I actually said this on the new Super Mario Bros. Episode I did just to kick off the month. But what I have found, you know, as I get older and I experience more games, I come back to Mario, and the reason I devote a whole month to it, it's not just because Mario is iconic and the games are still good and they still hold up all these years later. It's because I still find new and exciting things about, I find them to be some of the most creative and inventive games that resonate with me more than almost any other games that I play. And it's I always have a hard time finding other games that I resonate with, and Mario, I almost always they almost all of them resonate with me. But yeah, I think we got, unfortunately, we have to wrap this up. I know we probably could go on longer, but we're running long on time. So let's do some shout outs here. Thank you both for joining me. Dan, let's start off with you. Where can people find you online, and what would you like to promote?
Oh gosh. Okay. You know what? This is Super Mario Galaxy 2. We'll have some fun with it. I'm going to pretend I'm the chimp. I am not going to promote. I'm going to challenge you to go find my stuff. We are available. Winterion Game Studios, we're based out of the DC area, produces Ion Gaming on YouTube. That's our Let's Play series, but it's also where we host our academic panel lectures. So we do talks at conventions like MAGFest, Too Many Games, Retro World Expo, around the U.S. So we do a lot of talks there. I am a writer and editor. I work with Pat Contry on the Ultimate Nintendo series of books. I highly recommend them if you have not gotten them. The NES and SNES books are terrific encyclopedias for those systems, and watch for the N64 one coming out soon. On top of that, I'm also a professor of computer game design at George Mason University. You can learn more about what we do at game.gmu.edu.
All right. Thank you very much, Dan. Cosmo, what do you got going on?
So my main focus is preserving Mega Man history, but also Japanese feature phone gaming history. So those two may not look related, but basically what I try to do is take Japanese-only materials, like written materials, put them into English, and also for Japanese feature phone games, which are basically flip phones in the early 2000s in Japan. There were a ton of lost games and unique games that were made for them. And basically what I'm trying to do is lead a charge to get as many preserved as possible before it's too late. So if you'd like to follow my journey or just help me out with these efforts, you can find me on my website, rockmancosmo.weebly.com. That's just rockmancosmo.weebly.com. And you can also find me on Twitter at rockmancosmo.
All right. And as usual for me, you can follow me on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at StillLoadingPod on all of them. If you want to support the show, you can do it in a number of ways. You can give it a 5-star rating or review on Apple Podcast or whichever podcasting app you use, because hopefully that helps more people find the show. It helps with, oh my gosh, visibility. I totally blanked on the word. Though I read somewhere on Twitter recently that that is not true, and apparently that's not a thing. So I have no idea anymore. But those reviews still make me feel warm and fuzzy, so please submit them. And you can also support the show monetarily if you so choose. And you can go to patreon.com/stillloadingpod. For $1 a month, you get all the episodes a few days earlier at a better bitrate. For $4 a month, you'll get all of that plus access to two bonus episodes every month. There's a good number of bonus episodes now. And for $5 a month, you'll get all of that plus access to the Patreon exclusive Still Bonding podcast, where my friend Erica and I bond over 007 and we go through all the movies beat by beat. And those there's a lot of content out there for you. Let me tell you, each episode's minimum 2.5 hours. And by the time this comes out, we will have up to the seventh. I think Diamonds Are Forever will be out. So there's already 7 Bond movies that we have covered. So yeah, patreon.com/stillloadingpod. And of course, the most important shout out is the Bit by Bit Foundation. The Bit by Bit Foundation is a nonprofit organization whose mission is to put video games and video game consoles in the hands of kids receiving inpatient care at hospitals. So if you want to support them, go to bitbybitfoundation.org and consider donating. And that's it. That's a wrap on Mario Month for this year. I hope you all enjoyed it. I can't wait for next year. No idea what the games and the topics for Mario Month next year will be, but that's always the fun of it, isn't it? So, Dan, Cosmo, thank you so much for joining me.
Thank you.
It's a pleasure.
And I will see you all next time.